Hello and welcome to this video, which is a complete history of gaming icon Bubsy. Before we get going, I wanted to lay my cards out on the table and say that this is a very genuine retrospective of Bubsy. Nothing ironic about it. As a dumb kid in the 90s, I played and really enjoyed the first two Bubsy games, and I'm still a little nostalgic for the character now. That is the mindset that I'm approaching this history with. Do those first two games hold up? Was Bubsy as bad as everyone says? That's just two of the questions I seek to answer. Bubsy has ultimately gained a weird immortality online, often held up as a bad example of how not to approach the mascot platformer genre. Bubsy is reviled by critics, but loved ironically for his meme potential at the same time. Everything about Bubsy, from the disastrous Bubsy 3D to the weird cartoon pilot, to the rare and highly collectible pieces of 1990s merchandise, is at the very least interesting. So this retrospective and history should be a lot of fun. Let's start our story way back in 1993 with the very first Bubsy game. Let me set the scene. In 1991, Sonic the Hedgehog released and became an overnight sensation for Sega, almost instantly rivaling Nintendo's Mario in terms of popularity. Virtually every major video game company would aim to follow Sega's example, picking a random animal out of a hat, giving him some attitude, and throwing him into a platformer game. All of these Sonic clones have become known as mascot platformers. Company Accolade were one of the many that wanted their own mascot platformer hit, and so Bubsy was born. Bubsy, the exclamation point t-shirt wearing bobcat, was the brainchild of Michael Berlin, a veteran of text-based adventure games who, after playing and enjoying Sonic the Hedgehog, wanted to create his own take on the mascot platformer formula for game studio Accolade. Accolade was originally in talks to create a platformer starring Chester Cheeto, but eventually went with Berlin's idea of creating a brand new character. The main thrust behind Bubsy's design was emulating classic Fleischer and Looney Tunes cartoons, making Bubsy animated, expressive, and comedic, while also retaining a cool attitude, with his personality meant to shine through thanks to intermittent voice clips. Meanwhile, the fast-paced platformer gameplay was inspired both by Mario and Sonic. Bubsy's debut was preceded by a blitz of hype and advertising, with Bubsy winning Electronic Gaming Monthly's Most Hype for a Character of 1993 award. The game and the advertising assault was a costly expenditure for Accolade, and the success of the company rested on Bubsy's furry shoulders. So Bubsy, in Claws Encounters of the Third Kind, released for the Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis in 1993. The game dared the player to navigate Bubsy through 16 colorful levels, collecting yarn balls along the way, and defeating an alien force of Woolies, intending to steal the Earth's supply of yarn balls. Bubsy does have some positives. It's zany and colourful and captures that classic cartoon style well. It has some interesting level themes, and the levels do allow for some exploration. And the jokes, quips, and animations gave Bubsy more personality than most mascot platformers at the time. The game also had some serious issues. Bubsy aimed to combine the styles of Sonic and Mario, but ultimately some glaring flaws held the formula back. The flow of the game was constantly disrupted by one-hit deaths, fall damage, and speed issues, with Bubsy moving way too fast at maximum velocity and way too slow otherwise. The game suffered as a result, and Bubsy was so fragile that exploring the complex levels required too much caution. One of the most interesting things about Bubsy was how heavy-handed Accolade's approach to promoting him was. A whirlwind of promos, competitions, and announcements leading up to Bubsy's release made Bubsy a game that was hard to ignore. In fact, in 1993, a pilot episode of a potential Bubsy animated series called Bubsy, What Could Possibly Go Wrong, aired a couple of times on American television around Thanksgiving, I believe. The pilot opted to have something of a Southern American feel to it due to a sponsorship deal with Taco Bell, starring Rob Paulsen, best known for voicing Yakko and the Brain in Animaniacs, as Bubsy. The pilot introduced a host of new characters and gave Bubsy a clumsy and obnoxious personality. Berlin and the Bubsy team apparently cringed when they saw the cartoon. Ultimately, the cartoon wasn't picked up for a series. Returning to the game, Bubsy actually received favourable to good reviews by most critics at the time, receiving some lavish praise and even winning a number of minor awards. Despite its blatant issues, and with the disastrous Bubsy pilot dead and buried, Bubsy still had potential to improve any shortcomings with a slick sequel. After the success and the cost of the first game, Accolade wanted to turn Bubsy into a full-blown franchise, so a sequel was planned, this time being developed by an in-house team and without the guidance of Berlin. Rumours abound that the team hated working on the game. They would use Bubsy's catchphrases derisively in the office, and even jokingly tortured Bubsy plushes. How did this anti-Bubsy team do making a Bubsy game? Not great. Bubsy 2 deviated from the original in almost every way. Any level of cohesive level design, enemy design, or story from the first game was replaced in this sequel, with an approach that can be best described as complete chaos. The levels, though quite diverse, are vast and maze-like. The enemies are completely and utterly random, placed all over the levels lazily, and from a technical point of view, the sheer chaos going on screen leads to pretty regular lagging and frame rate drops. It's an experience that acts as an assault on the senses. The game does have a few merits. There's a pretty huge amount of levels, and you can choose to enter into one of dozens of levels to start the game, making it an ambitious, non-linear experience. It also offered some couch co-op, as the second player could control a smaller Bobcat character and either help or harm Bubsy. There were also tweaks, like allowing Bubsy to take 3 hits before dying, and more power-ups available, including an actual Nerf gun, the result of a partnership between Accolade and the Nerf gun guys. Once again, the shocking truth is that Bubsy 2 received generally positive reviews upon its release. If you take a look at contemporary reviews and do a little tot-up, it looks like critics actually favoured Bubsy 2 over the original game, even. One person who wasn't particularly thrilled with Bubsy 2 was original creator Michael Berlin, who claimed the team had no idea what made the original game and character popular. I dare say I think Berlin is right. Bubsy 1 offered a framework that needed some extra work, but proved popular at the time. This sequel felt messy and completely random in comparison, throwing Bubsy haphazardly into worlds that made no sense and weren't fun to play through. From my perspective, there are definitely worse games out there on the Genesis and SNES, but at the same time it's shocking to experience how much of a mess most of the levels are, how grating the music is, how badly Bubsy still controlled. The opportunity to build on the original game had gone to waste. Bubsy 2 was originally going to be ported to 2 handheld consoles as well, the Sega Game Gear and Nintendo Game Boy. But only the Game Boy port was eventually released, and it sucks. While the game does have less busy levels, the Game Boy port is inferior to its console counterpart in almost every way. In particular, the lack of backgrounds and some of the atrociously ugly graphics strip the game of its kooky art style and presentation, leaving nothing but a husk behind. A final 2D Bubsy game released in 1994 for the Atari Jaguar. Bubsy in Fractured Furry Tales, a fairy tale themed romp through a selection of familiar children's storybook worlds. This was actually planned to be a port of the original game released for the Jaguar, but somewhere along the way a new game was developed and built on top of the original instead. I think it's fair to say that Fractured Furry Tales is just plain bad. All of the problems of the previous games are still present, but they're now coupled with some of the laziest level design and most unoriginal art direction that Bubsy had yet experienced. The decision to throw Bubsy into a fairly generic fairy tale themed game shows you just how creatively bankrupt the series had become, even though this was only the third installment. Weirdly, Bubsy's iconic red exclamation point is actually yellow in this game, due to, apparently, a glitch rather than an intentional design choice. Furry Tales merged the worst concepts of the previous two games together, back were the one-hit deaths from the first game, and making a return was the confusing, labyrinthine level design philosophy of the second. If we ignore the Game Boy port, then Fractured Furry Tales was definitely the first abject failure in the Bubsy line of games, if judged from a critical and commercial standpoint. If you couple it with the Game Boy port, it's clear that Bubsy's reputation was plummeting in the mid-90s. In 1995, Super Bubsy released on Windows, a revamped version of the original game with smoother graphics, cleaner sound effects, and tweaked music. While I personally preferred Bubsy's pixelated Genesis appearance, some elements of the game's backgrounds look a lot nicer in Super Bubsy. Perhaps the most notable thing about Super Bubsy was the fact that the animated pilot was preserved for future generations on the disc. Collecting special bouncing TVs in the game unlocks snippets of the pilot for players to enjoy. Apparently in the mid-90s, another 2D game tentatively planned to be Bubsy 3, No More Mr. Nice Guy, was at one point proposed but abandoned early on. Instead, Michael Berlin was brought back to lead a team and attempt to reverse Bubsy's dwindling popularity by working on a 3D game to release for the upcoming Sony PlayStation. Berlin insisted on trying to craft a three-dimensional game, and so the infamous Bubsy 3D was born and released in 1996 for the PlayStation. Its faults are many and pretty obvious. As an early 3D experience, the game suffered from a pretty bad camera and control scheme, with Bubsy controlling like a tank and the camera primitively switching to an overhead view to facilitate precise jumping every time Bubsy's feet left the ground. It wasn't a great experience and paled in comparison to later 3D games. Furthermore, the game looked very evidently unfinished, favoring colorful polygons in favor of textured environments. The game was left looking akin to a beta development level rather than a finished product. When you couple these issues with Bubsy's wisecracks, which at this stage in history were wearing real thin, you've got a recipe for disaster. In the game's defense, the small dev team led by Berlin were pioneers who had no prior experience working in 3D. They were flying by the seat of their pants, and according to Berlin, witnessing Mario 64 at the 1996 Consumer Electronics Show made him realize Bubsy 3D was far from the perfect 3D platformer game. But at that stage, it was too late to scrap or restart the project. Looking back, one of the strangest things about Bubsy 3D was the reception it received. Reviews were mixed. Many magazines panned the game, but a surprising number gave Bubsy favorable to good reviews, with one magazine, PS Extreme, even giving Bubsy 3D a very generous 93%. I think the favorable reviews can be attributed to the fact that Bubsy was one of the very first titles for the PS1 in the Western world. If it would have released even half a year later, I'm sure it would have fared less favorably. Still, Bubsy 3D was far from being considered one of the worst games ever at the time of its original release. Similarly curiously, a sequel was proposed to Sony by the devs. Sony tentatively agreed, but ultimately requested the team move on from the mascot platformer genre due to the rise of the PlayStation's new mascot, Crash Bandicoot. And as a result, the successful Siphon Filter series was born. Crash Bandicoot, not poor sales or critical performance, sealed Bubsy's fate. Looking back, Bubsy 3D has gained a bad reputation, with many suggesting it's one of the worst games ever when critically reassessing it. Berlin has named it his biggest failing. It's certainly not a great game by any stretch of the imagination, but it does at least serve as an interesting time capsule of a nervy time of immense change for the video game industry. I'd argue there's enough truly awful games out there to save Bubsy 3D from being declared one of the absolute worst games of all time, and I can't help but respect and even enjoy the game a little, because it was, after all, made by a small dev team taking a complete stab in the dark at developing one of the PlayStation's first three-dimensional games. It was years later, in the long interim period between Bubsy games and with the rise of the internet, that Bubsy's legacy was re-evaluated by journalists and fans alike, with Bubsy increasingly emerging as the butt of many jokes. One particularly elaborate joke, Bubsy 3D, Bubsy visits the James Turrell retrospective, a sort of twisted fan game released in 2013 by Arcane Kids, who would later create Sonic Dreams Collection. The James Turrell retrospective is something of a commentary on video gaming and the world of art, as told through the unique perspective of Bubsy. Players are encouraged to explore a world reminiscent of Bubsy 3D, followed by an exhibition by artist James Turrell, before things turn a little bit surreal. An expanded version of this game would also release in 2017, very shortly before Bubsy would make his official comeback. The expanded version would offer an epilogue that would further throw into question the status of Bubsy. In another weird turn, Bubsy became briefly appropriated by portions of his own fanbase and reinterpreted as a depressed, busty, gender-swapped Bobcat, originally named Modern Bubsy, but later rechristened Spanky Bobcat. One question does arise at this point in time. What exactly was the internet's fascination with Bubsy? I think that the James Turrell retrospective, the re-evaluation of Bubsy 3D as one of the worst games ever, and all of the YouTube reviews of the early Bubsy games highlighted the character as a uniquely cynical one in the gaming world, engineered in a similar vein to Poochie to appeal to as many people as possible. Bubsy became the Jar Jar Binks of the gaming industry. All of this showed that Bubsy did have some sort of appeal, even if it was ironic. And unlike so many other mascot platformers, it was pretty obvious that Bubsy wasn't just going to be forgotten. And in the face of internet popularity, a two-pack of Bubsy's 16-bit adventures emerged on Steam in 2015. Bubsy 2 Fur, published by Retroism, showed that there was still an appetite for Bubsy and would mark the start of a brief, ill-fated comeback for the Bobcat. In June 2017, something unexpected happened. Hong Kong-based holding company BillionSoft announced that it had acquired the Accolade trademark and, together with developer Black Forest Games and publisher Tomo, announced it would resurrect several Accolade franchises starting with Bubsy, leading to the release of Bubsy the Woolies Strike Back in October 2017. It was the first official Bubsy game since Bubsy 3D from over two decades earlier. Was Bubsy's comeback worth the wait? Woolies Strike Back has some redeeming features, mainly the way it controls and the way that Bubsy handles, which is much better than any previous Bubsy installment. Bubsy's movement never felt so good. The rest of the game, though, is barely worth talking about. The game is competent, but ultimately a little boring and lacking in a few crucial areas. In total, the game clocks in at a mere 2 hours of playtime, making it shorter than even Bubsy's two Sega Genesis adventures. Pretty underwhelming for a big comeback game. Even worse, despite featuring a lot of the hallmarks of the original Bubsy game, the Woolies Strike Back lacked a lot of the charm that made Bubsy so appealing in the first place. It's actually a little confusing. Bubsy was pretty much memed back into existence, and Accolade gave us this. A game with bland visuals, forgettable music, anonymous environments, dull as dishwater basic gameplay. It's just boring. And not even bad enough to be meme-worthy. It just exists. The best thing that can be said about Woolies Strike Back is that in the run-up to the game's release, the marketing team behind Bubsy went into maximum overdrive, whipping up a pretty fantastic amount of interest in the game, and in the ultimate Notice Me Senpai moment, managed to get some interaction going with the folks who run Sonic's Twitter account. Definitely Bubsy's shining achievement. It does leave one asking, though, what was the point of all of this? The only real conclusion I can draw is that Woolies Strike Back was nothing more than a cynical cash grab, which is a shame, because a more earnest attempt to relaunch the character might, however slim the chance, have gone down a little bit better and helped to re-establish Bubsy as a gaming brand. Hell, a flat-out shitfest of a game would have been more entertaining than this. Unbelievably, we still have one final game to cover. Bubsy Paws on Fire, released in 2019. Unlike Woolies Strike Back, Paws on Fire was an auto-runner-style game developed by indie studio Choice Provisions, who had some prior experience with this genre of game and had worked on the Bit Trip series previously. In truth, just like the Woolies Strike Back, Paws on Fire isn't a bad game. It plays competently enough again. It's a simple Bit Trip runner clone with decently appealing graphics and quite a nice soundtrack. It is, though, pretty dull, and repetitive, and beyond starring Bubsy and co, didn't really have the zany atmosphere that Bubsy had become known for at that point. Uninspired would be the best way of describing Paws on Fire. Beyond the gameplay style switch, the most noteworthy aspect of this game is the inclusion of multiple playable characters, but that's about it. Interestingly, Bubsy does don a pair of shoes for this game, which makes thematic sense for an endless runner. But Bubsy was originally designed with shoes back in the early 90s, but the shoes were cut, most probably because they were too reminiscent of Sonic. It received a mixed critical reception, but unlike 2 years prior, none of the hype, ironic or not, nor the good faith that the previous game enjoyed was present this time around. Paws on Fire released not with a roar, but with a whimper, and despite being relatively recent, I almost forgot it existed until researching for this video. The most damning condemnation of Paws on Fire was the disastrous Kickstarter launched by Accolade to fund DLC of the game. Only 2/3 of the proposed total was raised, a clear sign that Bubsy fatigue had set in and Bubsy's resurrection was well and truly over. That draws this journey through Bubsy's past to a close, and leaves us with the ultimate question: was Bubsy ever good? I'd put forward the argument that Bubsy was ultimately a one-hit wonder. The first game was flawed, but the formula and the character had some potential, potential that was ultimately squandered by a lack of direction in later games. Without any firm direction, the series quickly faded away, stumbling through two inferior 2D games, a catastrophically bad 3D adventure, which seemed like the final nail in the coffin, and then two more recent games which I assume have finally killed off Bubsy for good. Good night, sweet prince. And on that depressing note, we're done. If you enjoyed this video, please consider giving it a like and subscribing for more gaming stuff in the future. I've done a few other history videos on franchises like Oddworld, Gex, and Marvel vs. Capcom, so check those out too if you want more. Thanks, and see you next time.